I want to talk to you about those moments in your life, that experience, those experiences that actually literally changed your life. And I want to share two moments in my life that changed my life forever. Let's put this picture up. In 1988, February 14th, very coincidental, I landed at JFK and eventually went to the city. My first day from the I moved to the United States from Seoul. And this is the first time I tried a McDonald's hamburger. You know how they say that love was what? Love is at first sight? Well, that's not true. For me, it was love at first bite. I heard stories about this great country that they were made of streets of gold. And I realized this was true when I came this day. And the rest is history. I became a loyal customer. And my 1 million burger since, or something like that, it changed me. Okay, all jokes aside, let's move down. The real moments that really changed my life, there are two actually, that literally changed the very fabric of my life. And when my sons, Nathan and Josh, were conceived. Now, you can see the sonogram. In 2006 and 2011, I saw these aliens in my wife's womb. And let me just tell you, I don't remember the exact dates. That should tell you how important McDonald's was. But I know that I saw the sonogram. I don't know exactly when, but I remember seeing Nathan's sonogram, and I remember seeing Josh's sonogram. And some fathers say that they have a hard time establishing an emotional connection with their children until, you know, someplace in adolescence, whether it's a symbolic gesture with baseball or throwing catch or playing catch or going to the game, eating a hot dog in the stand in Yankee Stadium. But for me, when I saw the sonogram, when I saw, you know, God knit these aliens, I was, literally, my heart leapt. Like, you know, I would tell you, yeah, it was just a picture, but when I saw it, I was just like, oh. I felt an instant automatic connection. That looks like me. You go, how does it look? I don't know. That looks like me. And ever since that conception, that 1 year before they were even born, I felt an instant connection. And now when I see them, the spring of 2014, when I see them, you know, beasting food and driving me bananas. Nathan says, I love driving you bananas. That's my job. It fills my heart with such joy. You know, it brings me so much happiness. And when I see them hurt, or in pain, or even the thought of them being hungry or lost or confused out there somewhere in the world, I feel a trepidation I can't even describe. If anything, if I could prevent any type of pain or struggle, any type of struggle or pain or turbulence that they would go through in their life, I will stop whatever I'm doing, fly from anywhere, run anywhere, and running is not that easy for me anymore, but I will go and do it because I don't want them to be hungry or hurt or rejected. And this is the mystery of the last week of Lent. God the Father, who loves his only son, his one and only son, who's the perfect father, who loves Jesus more than I could ever love two of my sons, which I love with everything I have. The question of how God the Father allowed Holy Week to actually take place in history. How God the Father allowed what the Bible calls the darling of heaven to be crucified. How the angels wept and complained and we're yelling at how this type of injustice could take place. The cosmos, the earth was in confusion. How Jesus, who committed no sin, who healed others, who loved everyone with everything he had, was hung on a tree by an angry mob. How could God the Father allow that to happen? This is what Isaiah says in Isaiah 53. And for those of you who are atheistic or agnostic or searching for faith, I want you to know this is 1,300 years before Jesus was ever born. Isaiah prophesizes through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. He writes a prophetic motif in this book. And this is what he pens. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we consider him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was what? Read that with me. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities, our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. And by his wounds we are healed. We are all like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity, the sins of us all. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life an offering for sin, he will see his offering, prolong his days, that the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. Why did God allow Holy Week to take place? Watch this video, and we'll come back.
Not afraid of getting Father, please, can't you do something? I know that you must hear my cry. I thought I could handle the cross of your side. Father, remind me why does everyone want me?
The question that we want to answer today in the last week of Lent is, how does the cross shape the depth of our spirituality and ultimately our commitment to live for Jesus? This, for 2,000 years, has been observed by the church the week that Jesus died. Today, as we look to John chapter 3, the classic passage in where most people quote the gospel. But I want to make it very clear that apart from the cross, there is no church. Apart from the cross, there is no Christianity. Apart from the cross, there is no power or no reason to have hope in salvation. A lot of people don't understand that John 16 is not a doctrine. People quote it like it is. John 3 actually is a conversation with Nicodemus, a Jewish leader, a Jewish teacher who understood salvation in a certain way. And Jesus revolutionized his perspective on why he came to the earth, of what the gospel is, how to make sense of the miraculous work, the renewal of all things that God was doing through Jesus. And Nicodemus, as you read, Cindy, read it for us in a beautiful way, couldn't understand what Jesus was saying, just like a lot of people in urban culture cannot understand the cross. And truthfully, the cross can be offensive to people in urban cities, because the cross says you are sinful, you are evil. And you go, I'm not evil, I'm nice, I'm good, I'm an okay person, I'm like not that person or this person that raped or murdered or stolen things. I'm a decent person. And the cross abolishes that notion, because Nicodemus couldn't understand the necessity of the cross. And this is what Jesus had to use this Jewish context in Numbers 21 because he was a Jewish teacher. And to understand verse 16 and verse 17, you need to understand verse 14. And I want everyone to read it with me. And this is what Jesus says to Nick. He says, just as what? Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness. The snake is imperative to understand when it comes to understand critically about the doctrine of sin or the story of sin, because the snake begins the origin of sin in the garden. And then you see in the wilderness, when God led Israel out of Egypt with power and might, you saw the Israelites in the wilderness, and you see the snake pop up again, perpetuating sin in the human heart. And what happened was, in Numbers 21, was all the people out in the desert, after they left Egypt with the powerful hand of God, were complaining to God and Moses, saying, God, you don't know what you're doing. We're out here starving and thirsty. What are you doing with our lives? There was this attitude of heart that said, God, you don't know what you're doing. Moses, you don't know what you're doing. And they were complaining. And what the text says is that a snake, venomous snakes, started to come and started to bite all the people of Israel. And if you read the narrative of Numbers 21 carefully, every single person in Israel was about to die. Last time I checked, if you get bitten by a snake, it's not a good thing. In the wilderness, it's even worse. So a venom entered the human heart in the Garden of Eden, in the origin of sin. In the wilderness, you see the sin perpetuating in the heart, complaining and saying, still, God, I want to be the Lord of my life. I want to control my life. I want to lead my life. And then you see the snake in the foot of the cross as well. And then Jesus says to Nicodemus, as the snake was lifted up in the desert, because God told Moses, when people were dying, get a brown snake and put it on a pole and lift it up. This is what the picture looks like. How many people ever saw this sign before? It's a universal symbol of emergency medical aid. It rooted, and its the origin starts in Numbers 21 in the Jewish story of how God delivered Israel out of the desert. And Moses put a snake on a pole and lifted it up. And God told Moses, whoever repents of their sin and says, I was wrong, God, I should trust you, I put my trust back in you, whoever looks to the snake, even though that seems foolish, why would you want to look at your own destruction? What does the snake have to do with salvation? But God had to make it very clear. If you want salvation, if you want to be forgiven, you have to be convinced of your wrong. This is why when an ambulance comes to your house, in the back of it, there's a snake on a pole, which is not very inviting. Why not a Care Bear? Why not a koala bear? Why not, you know, a dog? It's like, you know, they're coming. A cute thing is coming. But you see, when you're about to die in poison, you don't need cute. You need surgery. You need immediate salvation. So go back to the text. So now you can connect what Jesus was saying in the conversation with Nicodemus. You can make sense of what Jesus was saying to Nick. Just like Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. We're talking about the cross. Let me tell you right now, you cannot make sense the fact that God loved the world unless you're convinced of sin. Unless you are utterly convinced that you are sinful. Because look at the state of this passage. It says, for God so loved the world that what? He what? He? Read that with me. He gave. He gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. If you take Jesus out of the equation of John 3:16, you get one word, and that's perish. And read 17 very carefully, because a lot of people take this verse out of context. It says, for God did not what? Send his Son into the world to what? Condemn the world. A lot of people say, believe in Jesus. If you believe in Jesus, you won't go to hell. That's not true. If you believe in Jesus, you go to heaven. Hell has nothing to do with Jesus. The world was already at a condemned state because of sin, the origin of sin. And the sin that's in our heart, that was perpetuating out of our actions. But no, it says it didn't. Jesus wasn't sent to the world to condemn the world, but what? To save the world, what? Through him. He died on that cross, a horrible death, just for one. It can't be for humanity, it can't be for the world or the cosmos. Until you can reconcile our sin, your sin that put him on the cross, you are not a Christian. You can be culturally a Christian. You can be you could think you're a good person, and Christianity becomes a religion, how to enhance my life, how I can be a better person through the teachings of Jesus, but Jesus is just your teacher. He is not your Savior. There is a drastic difference of reconciling our sin to the cross. And this is why the Holy Week is probably the most important week of Lent. Because if you can't reconcile in your heart of our sinfulness, you can't reconcile the salvation and the blood and the love of God on the cross. The blood that pours out from the cross does not mean anything. I remember 6-7 years ago, one of the guys in our staff, Henry Kim, his friend Amin, the hipster, and Henry, the artist from LaGuardia, and SVA, started volunteering at our church. And he told Amin, the cross is offensive. He goes, look, man. And he said it a lot nastier than that. I mean, the dude is messed up. He said to Amin and me, like, I'm not good enough. If I wasn't good enough, why would I be at this church volunteering my time? I'm doing fine arts here. I'm helping people. I'm taking pictures. I'm serving God. How can you call me sinful? And there was one culmination in my office there when I'm in there. I mean, Henry said he was going to literally punch Amin out. And I was sort of curious to what might happen if that took place. But my sinful side, you know, I pushed it. I said, I bind you, devil. And I started to focus on what was happening. What was happening was the venom that was on his heart. To admit that you are not good, that you need salvation, that you need forgiveness, that you are what we used to call effed up, messed up, wretched. It was coming to shape. He actually stormed out of the office 3 times before he finally came back and said, all right, let's do this. And you know what? Salvation, real salvation, takes sometimes through the process of time, the conviction of sin, that's how it happens. It has to be a struggle. For some people, it's the other opposite extreme. Some people, you're offended. Other people, like, you're offended that God would die for someone like you because you feel like, I'm not good enough. I've done so many wrong things. The cross can work for good people, but it can't work for someone like me. Because someone like me doesn't deserve. I'm a piece of crap. I don't deserve Jesus. It could work for other people that haven't done this, 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 and this, but the things I thought and the things I've done, I am exempt from the cross. And what happens is sometimes either you make big of yourself or you make too big of your sin. And it comes bigger than the cross. That's a spit on the cross. Whatever side you're in, we have to reconcile that Jesus hung up on that cross to save those who will look to him with their sin and find forgiveness. All God's people say, amen. Amen. So, how does the cross shape our spirituality, the depth of our spirituality and our commitment to the gospel, living out of faith? Well, first lesson we learn is that the cross is completely what? Obsolete to those who aren't convinced of their sins. Now, if you are not convinced of your sins, coming to church is just religion. How to enhance life. How to meet a network. How to get people, good community around me. That's what Christianity becomes. It becomes like any other religion. It is not a transformative experience. If the cross is completely obsolete, then evangelization, telling other people about Jesus, is not necessary. Because there is no dire state of the world. Missions is not necessary. Why go to the remote jungles of Amazon or Afghanistan or the treacherous places in the Middle East where they will kill you for being a Christian? It's not necessary. And for a lot of people in urban culture, even people that were born Christians into Christian families, this is where they're at. The cross is a little bit out of date. It's a little bit too bloody. It should be photoshopped a little bit. It's not good PR. You can't use that on Twitter. The cross is something that when barbarians used to use, an idea of God that's too messy. It's not sophisticated enough. That's what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 1:18, that the cross, the message of the cross, is foolishness to those who are perishing. It offends. But it is the power of God to those what? Who are being saved. Today, the question I have for you is how is the cross shaping you and your faith? How is it? Because if the cross is where you find forgiveness, is where you find salvation, then when you come to church, is a place of worship, not a place of attendance. It's a place when you close your eyes, you feel the dirt being cleansed from you, and love of adoration comes to Jesus. The cross has to shape our faith. When it doesn't, it's not real faith. Let's move down. Now, Jesus says, just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. Now, what happens for everyone here? What happens to you when you really understand this? This whole Passion Week was for you and me. Tell someone next to you, Jesus died for you. And now tell the person behind you, even though you are so messed up. Tell someone, you don't even deserve it. You deserve to die. No, I'm kidding. What happens when you understand the fact that you changed that word for God so loved, not the world, the cosmos, but when so God so loved, and you put your name in it? What happens when you put your name in that statement? And it actually applies to your sins and mine, your darkness and mine, your evil and mine, the things that you've thought and the things that you've done. It revolutionizes everything. I remember that night when Amin and I was lying in the floor with Henry. Don't think anything, it's not weird. just that we were really tired for going back and forth outside and inside, the struggle, the offense, and then the power of God coming. And then we saw Henry on the floor just weeping like never seen before. And then I smiled. We won. I wanted to punch him after he was saved. But we knew we won. Why? Because God's power showed up. And we knew something was happening that Jesus was describing to Nicodemus, that the Spirit was giving birth to Spirit. You see, you can be a Christian by culture, flesh to flesh, from your parents, or from a friend. But when the Holy Spirit comes and regenerates the heart, overshadows that heart, said, God, I am a sinner. There was him weeping. Next thing you know, he tells his parents. They got into a whole argument about coming to Christ and etc. He said, I'm going to give my life to Jesus and I'm going to serve him. And this is the only story worth telling. I'm not going to that school in California. I don't care about film. I'm going to tell people about Jesus. We're like, yay, we're winning. And parents says, we're going to disown you. He goes, and this is what he said. I don't care if I'm homeless. I'm going to still follow Jesus. I was like, wow, that's pretty good. That's a pretty good line. I'm going to be homeless and still follow Jesus. When the cross makes sense to a sinful heart, you will not be the same again. If the cross makes sense, then Jesus becomes everything. The Holy Week is the most critical week of the year because it makes or breaks your faith. Jesus is not a good moral teacher. Jesus is not just a nice guy. Jesus is your savior or not. So, how does the cross shape our spirituality and how we live our faith? Last lesson we learned is that the cross is completely revolutionary to those who are convinced of their sin. This is why we do missions. This is why we have this place in this theater. Because the good news is worth sharing, no matter what the cost, because God's love is so great. So we want to make big of God. The point of 180 is not to make big of 180. Oh, we want more members than that church and that church. We're more innovative. We're great at this and that, so we want you to come to our church. No, that's not the point. The point of 180 is always the point of the church, and the point of what Jesus started is to make big of the cross. Big of God, big of Jesus, what he's done, what he started, and to join him. That is what revolutionizes us in our faith. So today's question, as we pray, is how is the cross shaping you? Let's stand and pray together. Will you lift your hands with me? For those watching this message online or will, I feel a very clear prophetic spirit. I'm speaking to some of you. Some of you are culturally Christian. You were given flesh to flesh, birthed from flesh to flesh, but not spirit to spirit. This reconciliation of my sin to Jesus' cross is the only way you can make sense of the love of God. Today I pray that the Holy Spirit would come and bring conviction on sin. And I pray that there would be a spiritual rebirth, a conviction of what Jesus really did or will do this week. So I'm going to pray. Holy Spirit, We ask that you would come now. You would give birth from spirit to spirit. You would bring a revelation of your love, the Father's love, in a deep way. Come to the Father, Jesus said. I am the only way to the Father. I am the way, the truth, and the life. So today, will you come to the Father? Will you come to the Father and pray to understand the cross again? For the first time, or again, because you've forgotten. Because that's the only thing that's going to bring zeal for worship. When the cross is obsolete, there is no worship. It's just, oh man, what am I doing here so long? I want to watch my show. I want to go on ESPN. I want to go eat. When the cross becomes revolutionary, all those things don't matter. You love being in his presence. It brings worship. It fuels worship. Let's go to him now. Make this our prayer. Come to the Father. Father, we come before you this afternoon. I love that night, that line from the song, Why? When the Father says to the Son, the Father says to Jesus, the power in your blood will break all of the lies. If you ever questioned your self-worth, if you ever questioned if you have what it takes to count in this world, if you ever questioned doubts about yourself, how bad or good your heart is, the power in His blood brings the truth that God loves you in spite of everything that you and I have done and will do. The gospel is actually not the end of the narrative. Doesn't happen on the cross, you see. It's not that one action. No, Jesus' gospel, His preaching was that when He dies on the cross, I am the truth, the way, and the life. When I die on the cross, you get my Father. You get God. You get God living with you. You get God leading you. You get God comforting you. You get God healing you. You get God walking with you. You get God living with you. That's our news, folks. And that's why I come to the Father today. Jesus made it possible for us to come to our Dad who loves us unconditionally and who has brutally murdered His Son to save us. Let's worship Him today. Remember Him today. Come to the Father. Go to the Father now. Receive His love for you. Love Him back. Come to the Father.
Come to the Father. Though your gift is small, broken hearts, broken lives,
bow your heads for the benediction. For those of you that want the spiritual birth, talk to your small group leader, talk to your friend, or even see me today, and we'll pray with you for that spiritual birth. Because God is poking at some of you. As we meet in Easter at Central Park, 845 acres of space. That's a large space. As you invite and pray into this message of God's love to our friends and family into this city, remember why Jesus died. Let it fuel you with a passion to pray against the enemy and our own inconveniences and our own sin and our own humanity and our own flesh, so that God's love can be glorified and we can make big of Jesus. We can make big of God the Father, and we can make big of the cross. So may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. All God's people say, amen. God bless you. We'll see you in Central Park.
Good afternoon, everybody. How are you guys loving that springtime weather out there, right? It's about freaking time, right? My name is Stu Still. I'm a small group leader here at 180 Church. I want to welcome you all to our Sunday service. Before we get started, we have just a couple of quick announcements to go through. We're going to start out with tithes and offerings. You know, here as members at 180 Church, we believe that God is the center of everything that we have. He is our provider. He is our source of everything. And one of the ways that we as believers and we as members here at 180 Church give back to God is through tithing so that we can continue God's work here on earth. So if you're a member here at 180 Church, I just want to remind everyone to continue to tithe faithfully. You can give either at the info booth in the back. You can tithe online through Chase Quick Pay at offering at 180church.tv. Or you can send an offering through our website through PayPal at 180church.tv. Our next announcement is about prayer texts. And we have this resource available so that in the things that we're going through in our life that we can't really deal with on our own, that we need a little bit of help, a little bit of God's help, we have this prayer text line available. It's 5397-PRAYER, and we also have an email, prayer@180church.tv. And when we send these texts out, when we send these emails out, we're not just praying by ourselves to God, but we're praying with other people who see these texts, who keep them in confidence, but they also pray for the things that are going on in our lives so that we're not struggling with these things alone, but that we are going through things as a family of believers, as God intended us always to be. So again, if you have those things going on in your life, it's 5397-PRAYER, or you can send an email to prayer@180church.tv. Our next announcement is about sharing the gospel. And we have so many different ways that we can share the gospel. We have our Facebook page where we keep everybody up to date on the things that are going on in the church. We also have our YouTube account where we put up all of the sermons after Pastor Sam and whoever does them. You know, it's an easy way to share the gospel, to put it on our own Facebook pages, to share the YouTube sermons, to put them up on our Twitter pages or any other of these, you know, different social media sites. And it's really good to do that because we're sharing the gospel. We're doing as Christ called us to do, go make disciples of all nations. And a lot of people have seen the gospel through these YouTube videos, through these posts on Facebook and Twitter and all of them, and people have really come into a great relationship with Christ. So we just invite everyone to continue sharing the gospel, to be part of this group that's here online, not just here in the theater, but again, we're a global community of believers. So let's just continue to share the gospel. Let's grow this community. And as always, you know, Pastor Sam has his Twitter account. It's Sam180Church, where he's available for you to ask any questions that you have. Anything that you want to talk about, he's there ready to go. Our next announcement is about small groups, and small groups are where we get together to go a little bit deeper into the Word, to see where God is really working on those places in our lives. And we do it in a smaller setting, a little bit more intimate, so that we can talk with the people who are going through many of the same things that we're going through, or maybe have even gone through those and can say, hey, I've been there, I've done that, I know what it's like, but this is what God can do in your life. You know, we're all friends along the journey in a small group. So if you're not in a small group, I want to invite you to come and join one. You can talk with Andrew Park. We meet in the city. We meet in Staten Island. We have groups for whatever age range you're in, wherever you are in life. We have a group where we can put you in, and you can really begin to see what God is doing in your life. Our next announcement is about the Bible reading group. And you know, the Bible is really an awesome book, and you know, sometimes people think about the Bible and they think, well, you know, sometimes it's a little bit confusing, sometimes I don't know exactly what's going on, but the Bible really does speak to us in our lives. You know, I'm taking an online class, and we were talking about Revelation yesterday, and I'm sure when most people think about Revelation, they think, oh, it's the end of the world stuff, right? It's not just that, but again, you know, there are letters in there that John wrote to seven churches, and a lot of the things that he said to those churches apply to our lives as well, you know, and this is just one small sample of the things that we can get out of the Bible when we read it, when we pick it up, when we go through it. So we have the Bible reading group where we can go into it in just a chapter a day, just a little bite-sized piece, just that little small nugget of it to really start to see what God is saying, what he said to the early church, but still applies to all of our lives today as well. So if you're not a member here, we want to invite you to join us. It's 180brg.tumblr.com. I really think you're going to enjoy it. If you start to read the Bible with us, you can really hear God speaking to you through it. And our next announcement is about the Day in the Sun. Day in the Sun is next week. Easter is next week. Easter High Five. It's going to be really awesome. We're going to be meeting at the Arthur Ross Pinedum on the east side. Last year, we were on the west side. This year, we're going to be on the east side. We're starting everything at 12:30, but we're asking everybody to get there for 11:15. 11:45 or 11:15, somewhere around there. Let's say 11:30. Let's split the difference right there. That way, just in case there's traffic, just in case you're not sure where you're going, just in case you have stuff that you got to bring there, and you'll know you're in the right spot when you see all the balloons. We're going to have all kinds of balloons and markers so that everybody can know where we're going. It's really going to be awesome. We just want to invite everyone to continue to pray and ask God for the names of those people that God wants you to bring into a relationship with Him, to bring out in this really non-threatening, really awesome day. I mean, we've had a bunch of people come up here and say what Day in the Sun has meant to them and how it's been just, you know, people getting together, real non-threatening way to see that, you know, we are a family of believers who want to be here, who want to be in relationship with Christ. And that's really warm and inviting for people who have a lot of different conceptions about the church and what it's supposedly supposed to be. So again, Day in the Sun, Easter High Five, it's going to be next Sunday. Don't show up here. You're going to be pretty lonely. It's in Central Park. You can see the map there. And again, I talked about how we have our Facebook page. We're going to have all the information up there as well. And also, we're just inviting everybody to pray for really good weather. In fact, we're going to pray right now. Father, we just want to pray, God, for your blessing. Yeah, I just go right into it, you know. Why not, right? Why not? Otherwise, because if I stop, then I'm going to brain fart, which I'm in the middle of doing right now. Thanks. Anyway, so Father, we thank you for what you're going to be doing next week at Day in the Sun, at Easter High Five. We want to pray, God, for your blessing to just shower Central Park next week. We want to pray, God, for beautiful, glorious weather that would make even today look like a, you know, kind of okay day. We want to pray, God, for beautiful weather. We want to pray, God, for beautiful fellowship. We want to pray, God, for your presence to really invite people in and just wrap yourself around people so that they really can feel your presence. They can feel you calling out to them, and that we would tell many, many stories about the great things that you did this Sunday on Easter. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I think those are all of the announcements. As always, you can always find all of this and more at our website at 180church.tv.